the wetland boundary that we have.
Scott, before you sit down, Mr. Chairman, may I follow up on that issue? I think the thing that's confusing the issue is that the building envelope, if it were literally taken as that area within which a structure can be legally placed because of setbacks required from wetlands, as calculated from the edge of wetlands due to slope, and those minimum state requirements, side, rear, and front yard setbacks, I think that typically defines what the building envelope is. The exception is obviously that septic systems are allowed to be placed closer to a property line than our side yard setback allows a structure to be placed. Therefore, the building envelope jumps out closer to property lines, and I don't know necessarily that it's appropriate that it jumps closer to wetlands. I'm a little confused by that, but I must trust our people at the state level, both DEP and the other agencies, for reviewing the plans appropriately. The confusion I must admit that I do have, though, however, is why the building envelope does abut the wetland with absolutely no buffer at all. Could you explain, for example, on lot 10, why there is no setback requirement at all from the line that's indicated as a wetland line? This is on drawing C101.
I think it's more detailed on C105.
Yeah.
Do you have drawing C-105 there, Tom?
Oh, I'm sure we all have it somewhere here.
There is a setback from the wetland shown on that drawing. Now, the setback does terminate at the location of the septic system to allow the septic system in closer than that 33, 35 feet.
I don't think we do.
C-102.
Yeah, we're showing a 33-foot setback from the wetland there, except for the septic system.
Okay, and would a similar situation hold true for, again, I'm looking at C-101, lot 11, coming down what appears to be, I'm assuming, a fairly steep slope downhill. The building envelope there abuts the wetland.
It shows a 15-foot in one direction, but it doesn't measure the...
C-105 will show that setback also.
What does that imply for drawing C-101, its purpose? This is the plan that was submitted with this package.
The site layout and utility drawings are intended to show more detail for those types of matters.
I understand this isn't the document we'll be signing. It's...
Yeah, the plat plan doesn't show all that detail and setbacks from wetlands and so forth.
I'll simply refer a question to our planner. Is it not appropriate then that the plans be revised so that they all indicate similar? Either be revised to indicate the same level of, not level of detail, but consistent setbacks throughout, or what's confusing to me is someone signs a deed and they have a plat plan, which is at the county registry, and does not provide a lot of detail because of scale, and I don't have a problem with that. I understand working with different scales. But then when I go to the code enforcement officer and he has the application, he has your package on file and he goes to various drawings, there's conflicting information among the drawings. It would just seem appropriate that either the conflicting information or the drawing that has that either be deleted from the set or everything brought to the same level of accuracy, but to reflect the same information, that if setbacks do exist, that at least graphically they're illustrated on drawing C-101 to be there.
I think he wants to. I think what you're suggesting is that the detail on the 40 scale plan be on the recording plat, which is 100 scale, and I'll have to ask.
Well, I'm not really saying that. I'm
a reference be made to the detailed plans, whichever.
That would be appropriate.
I prefer that.
Believe me, I understand the issue of working with different scales and what can be shown at one scale and not at another. But if the general site plan, which sounds like a real official document to me, that it neither shows the phasing consistent with the rest of the package nor shows setbacks from some of the wetland areas, because it's at a larger scale, well, at a smaller scale, put it that way, at a smaller scale, it's difficult to show that as accurately as it is a more detailed plan. It should at least, some indication should be given on the plan that there is a setback that exists there.
That plan is part of our application, and we would be required to conform to all plans submitted. What you're suggesting is that we give notice of the detailed plans.
And that all plans, since all plans are referenced, that all plans are consistent one to the other in terms of phasing numbers and
phasing.
Setbacks.
I have one other question, and it deals with the setback only that the original site for what is now lot 2 in phase 1 was in a buffer area. The new site doesn't. We talked about this earlier. Does Mr. Decker have a copy of the HHE 200 for that new site?
I do.
I'll take your copy.
You don't have one?
No, we never got it. That's what I said earlier. We never got a copy of the HHE 200 for that chamber system.
I'm sorry. For what lot?
Lot 2, phase 1.
I know the local planning inspector has it.
Okay, the planner's handed me a note here. No, it's a different location. So if we change the lot number and the location of it, he's lost. Let me just check it.
I don't have them in my file right now, but we'd be happy to get you.
What the note's saying is that they really didn't do new test pits, that somehow it got in the wrong location, that was lot 3 is now lot 2, which that I said that's easy enough to follow. But we've moved a site about 150 some odd feet.
No, not what I did. Look around.
Do you have a copy of the plan as it was at the time of the preliminary approval? I can show you exactly what I'm talking about.
That's fine.
I don't.
Hey,
You look at lot, at map C-102.
I think I know what you're talking about, Mr. Chairman. That system, there was another test pit located on that lot during the time that the engineers were doing the nitrate analysis. That was
I looked through 18 inches of plans, and I never saw another test pit in that location in the site. And that's if they'd been there, I can read those as well as anybody else. That would have sufficed, but I've never found one in that location.
Well,
it never shows in any of the original, go back to the beginning application.
No, this would have been done subsequent to the preliminary approval, because it was during the period where we were doing the nitrate analysis mm-hmm. for the DEP submission.
Mm-hmm.
This plan doesn't show any test pit locations. Do you have any reference?
No.
The final plan you approved.
Pardon?
I have a copy of the final preliminary.
Yes.
Right here.
We'll bring it here, please.
You'll be right here. The test pit for this site was down here now, but in here. More muscle in the inner pieces.
Well, I need to know what you were looking at. I need a reference to it.
It would be the
C-102
of
preliminary?
Yep. Whatever shows phase one
in detail.
Do you have that?
It'd be the layout and utility.
Don't have that plan.
I know. That's the point.
Well, we don't have the copy. We assume you do.
I do at home. I didn't bring all 18 inches of reading material.
That's all there is? It's more than 18 inches.
C-102. Of the preliminary?
Yeah.
I know it shows. That's right.
No, he doesn't. I asked him. I talked to him on the phone today. He's right here.
Excuse me. Attorney, you have the HHT 200 form for lot 2X.
Ernie Mack Vane, Code Enforcement Officer.
Hi, Ernie.
Steve, when I talked with you today, what I have is the same forms that I went over with you a couple mm-hmm. weeks ago. The question is whether or not, besides the fact that they reversed the numbers, the question is whether or not the distances are accurate with regards to the revised map, as I understood it.
Mm-hmm.
And that is a question that I have to refer to Peter, because I don't know that answer. But I do have all the test pits. In fact, there has been a memo submitted to the board stating whether the systems were separated or not. The number of bedrooms, number of gallons, etc. So I have reviewed not only the current test pit borings that you people have, but also the initial test pits. I visited all the sites, required additional test pits, and those all have been documented. But the one problem area that I see is the distance or the location of that particular test pit in what is now Lot 2. The distance.
I realize it's 250 feet away from where the other one was, and it gives no reference to any test pit number.
Right.
Yeah, I don't want to belabor
and that's,
it.
And that's been brought up to
Peter. It seems
to
be quite evident that it's a different site, and we don't have the form of that site.
Either it's a different site or it's not mapped correctly, one or the other.
I can't answer that technical question, Mr. Chairman.
The answer is, Ernie gave me a copy of the HHE 200 form for lot 2S and the location that it's shown. I do have it, and you have it. Well, I'll show you. I have the copy of what Ernie gave me.
I have one that shows it's 150 feet south of Jordan Farm Road.
No, it said 250 feet plus or minus from the property line. And Steve Ferrer's letter corrected that to be 315 feet, because at the time he didn't have any control. And that's the letter that we handed you this evening.
It shows the only measurement on it shows us correctly south.
I think we should move on.
310, not 315.
310.
Let's move on.
Mr. Frensco, if we could move off that point and continue with the conditions that were placed by the board last year, I'd like to go back to F because I'm not sure about what the applicant's response was. F said that the building envelope on the southeastern portion of Lot 6 be eliminated. I don't think it said that the building envelope totally be eliminated. I think this question was just having it moved in order to ensure that no residential construction or septic system construction occurred in close proximity to the existing wetland. Now, do I understand the applicant's response is that the building envelope was not moved at all? This is condition F.
Mm-hmm.
If you have the plan.
Yes.
There is a note on the plan.
Right.
That prohibits any building construction within that envelope on the southern portion of Lot 6.
But the question is the building envelope itself reconfigured? I mean, what sense does it make to have a building envelope and then have a note that says...
I don't see any building envelope.
Yeah, it's there.
So that's the question, I guess.
You're looking at those, yeah.
I don't see it.
May I add a comment? With
no, it says no septic or building in this envelope.
There are two differences. If you look at final subdivision phase one, which is the plat plan, on that plan, on Lot 6, there is a building envelope shown on the other side of Farm Pond Road, which within the building envelope says no septic or building in this envelope. If you go to the most recent general site plan, C101, that same lot does not have a building envelope, but it has a note saying construction of buildings and or septic systems shall not occur in Lot 6 south of Farm Pond Road. I would believe either of those achieve the aim, but there certainly is discrepancy on how it was approached.
What's wrong with water?
Oh, okay.
The recording plat would be the first document you described. That makes it clear that you can't do have buildings or septics within that area.
Judith, having looked at the plan, I now understand, I think, what's been done. Does anybody have any further questions on this?
No. I was looking, I couldn't imagine what you were talking about.
Okay, G is that the applicant will meet with the Public Works Director, Police Chief, Fire Chief, Town Planner, Town Manager to discuss the town staff's recommendations regarding stop sign placement on Hunts Point Road, Farm Pond Road, Cove Road, Cove View Road, and Two Lights Road, and that the applicant will add said improvements to the final plan prior to submission. Maureen, do we have a sign-off on that?
That's been completed.
H is that the applicant indicates with detailed drawings the driveways serving certain lots can meet the public access waiver standards and that the proposed waiver roadways shall be deemed acceptable by the fire chief and the town planner prior to submission of the final plan. Has that been accomplished?
That's been reviewed, and there is a proposed motion for granting of those public access waivers for the board to consider.
Okay. I is that the post-development drainage system in the vicinity of Pine Ridge Road will be redesigned by the applicant's engineer so that there will be no net increase in runoff on adjacent properties, with these results being submitted for review by the town engineer prior to submission of the plan. Do we have a sign-off on that?
Yes, there's a letter from, I believe, the town engineer dated January where he specifically refused that issue and feels that there is no significant runoff.
And then J is that the applicant shall meet with the town planner, the public works director, and appropriate town staff to review the Farm Pond Road, Two Lights Road intersection design and make all recommended revisions prior to submission?
There was a more involved intersection design as part of the preliminary approval with the revised changes in the plan as part of the DEP approval, where the gravel road is no longer a through road. It's designed now as a driveway, and the town engineer and the public works director has approved that.
Okay. Thank you. That completes my part of it, for at least for starters.
Any other questions from the board members? Judith?
Yes. Drawing C-100, which I guess is going to be the recording plat. The recording plat today.
Two of them.
Okay. Small detail, but it's two lights for not Route 77. Over here.
Decker? Jordan Farm Road joins Two Lights Road, not Route 77, says Mrs. King.
It's okay.
Oh, I see. It's one of these. I didn't do it. The surveyor did it. Okay. Yeah. If it's incorrect, it'll be fixed. I think that is an old plan, believe it or not.
Thomas?
Just a couple of comments. I have noted that there have been, at least my concern raised on the flat plan, where there were buildings straddling property lines on abutting properties. Those buildings seem to have been either shifted or the ownership position correctly. That's appreciated. I would like to take a moment to talk about, I guess, the correspondence that we did receive. And the issue revolving around the Brown House, the property at the intersection of Two Lights Road and Jordan Farm Road. Would you please state once again your position with respect to either buffering or relocating the road in order to meet the concerns of that abutter?
I'll have to let Scott speak
sure.
to that.
The center line of Jordan Farm Road is very close to the center of the available space between the Brown home and the existing farmhouse, within a foot or so. So we felt that it didn't make a lot of sense to move that center line of the road one way or the other. It is basically in the center of the available space. Between the curb line and the right-of-way line on the south side of the road, you've got about 13 feet of vegetative space. There's the 10-foot border strip and the 3 feet of side slope. That there is a little bit of fill that's going in there, and but I think that some of the existing vegetation in that area can be preserved to create more buffering than would be created if it were just stripped and constructed with a 10-foot grass border strip.
I recall someplace where there was a reference, I think, from your attorney regarding the fact that that house is a non-conforming structure, because it is closed. There's been an issue raised in the correspondence now, although this has not been submitted early enough for everyone to have a copy of it. We received it this evening by that abutter talking about adding onto the second story of this house. Is there anything...
I'm not with you.
Excuse me?
I'm not up to speed with you folks, because we haven't been furnished with any information.
Okay. And you haven't had any discussion with the abutter regarding anything other than what occurred here at the last meeting?
I haven't. Mr. Kennedy may have.
I have. Has there been any discussions about additional buffering or any way in which you can accommodate his concern?
I'd certainly like to accommodate his concern. Being this time of the year, it's kind of hard to see what the vegetation really is. I have the aerial photographs we did in the for two summers, and there are some existing trees that happen to be on my side of the line that are quite tall, very bushy. I'll be glad to show you these. We will preserve those. And I could not plant a better buffer. We'd be glad to review it with the appropriate parties and see if we can add to some. I mean, I'm sympathetic, but unfortunately the property line is 10 feet or so from his house.
Now, for the record, you have adequate sight distance at that intersection?
Yes, sir.
For 40 mile an hour speed limit?
Yes, sir.
Okay. I'd also like to note on the record that we did receive a letter from the abutter, and in my opinion, there was some, threatening language in that letter that really concerns me as a volunteer member of the community and a planning board member, which I feel is inappropriate. Since the letter has not been introduced in the public record, I do understand the abutter's concerns. I think it's a very unfortunate set of circumstances where we, on the one hand, want to protect the existing farmhouse, which may come up as an issue later in this review. And we do have a property that is set closer than the middle of the town standards to an adjacent property line. So as a planning board member, I don't see that there's any way to resolve this issue, although I would say that if someone were to buy lot one and tear down the house, I'd be very concerned about the fact that would either happen, or secondly, that the road has been located in order to preserve that house, and there would be an opportunity to shift the road slightly if that were not the intent of this plan.
Well, given the amount of money I've spent in the last 6 months on that farmhouse, they better not tear it down. Mm-hmm. And given the price that I hope to sell it for, after the renovations, including new roofs, heating systems, windows, walls, insulation, wiring, complete new plumbing system, et cetera, I cannot conceive of anybody wanting to. It's not a tear down situation. It will be pretty well restored when I'm done.
I just want those issues to be discussed openly in a part of the record.
You'll put what buffer you can in here.
I think I'd like to follow up.
Tell him that.
Yeah, as Paul said, I will put in what buffering I can, as long as I don't destroy these trees that I'd be glad to pass around. I mean, it's...
There's the brown house, there's the farmhouse, there's the existing vegetation. Photograph the upper right-hand corner.
I guess my question is... Is there any technical reason why the curve in Farm Pond Road can't occur at what would be the northeast corner of the Brown property near the between that and the barn of the existing farmhouse? Why the curve can't occur there, proceed to Two Lights Road, and still intersect at a right angle, giving more of a buffer between the abutting property? I'm not talking about a diagonal from that point. I'm talking, I don't know, I'm just asking, is there a technical reason why you can't put the curve in the road back there and still bring the road let's limit it to technical questions at this point, and still bring the road to a perpendicular intersection with Two Lights?
If I understand you, Mr. Chairman, you're talking about the actually bringing the curve of the road probably in the front yard of the existing farmhouse.
Bringing it closer to that side, yes.
Off the top of my head, I don't know if it would, you'd have a reverse curve in there, and I'm not sure it would meet the requirements of your subdivision ordinance. You'd have two sharp curves right together there. Not a desirable situation.
Just to gain even 10 feet in the road, in the buffer between those lights, sides. Oh,
what?
I'm not sure it couldn't be done. It's a detail that would have to be worked out with the town engineer for sure, because I think he would have to accept something that's not allowed in your subdivision ordinance.
Okay. More questions? Judy?
I just want, since we're on the subject, one thing clarified for me. I thought I was just heard a few moments ago that the center line of the right-of-way was supposedly equidistant between the two buildings, and on the subdivision plat, because the farmhouse footprint has been revised, there are two different footprints I have on two different plans that are both recent,
but it looks to me like the right-of-way center line is much closer to the Browns' property, and I don't know how to make those two agree.
Which
I'm looking at the subdivision plat, which you call C-100A, shows the right-of-way line very close to Mr. Brown's property, and the other, the northerly edge of the right-of-way line, quite a distance from the farmhouse footprint, so I assume the center line also follows those discrepancies.
Yeah, I'm not sure that the farmhouse is located as accurately on that drawing as it is over on C-102. Again, C-102 is intended to show more detail.
I'd like to maybe say two things here. One, we keep getting reference to the fact that this plan was approved preliminary subdivision with no changes except for the road configuration. I'd like to quote out of the subdivision ordinance what the planning board has to follow in those terms. I'm reading from page 11. Let me give it a proper citation, which always takes me a moment to find. Under section 16-2-4, review and approval of major subdivision plans. Section 9, preliminary plan approval shall not constitute approval of the final plan, but rather shall be deemed an expression of approval of the approach submitted on the preliminary plan as a guide to preparation of the final plan. The reason I want to stress that is right now I'm the only voting member who was not in on the preliminary plan approval. I can only look at these plans with the eye of what is good planning and using the exercise that Ms. McKay went through on whether the terms of the preliminary approval had been met or so forth. I have real problems with the fact, especially with this roadway configuration, that originally we did not even have Mr. Brown's property on here. I had no idea that this was an issue. I think it was last year in the meeting before I asked it to please be plotted. And now I'm being told that it looks like there's three separate current plans that have different footprints for the farmhouse. I think this is a crucial issue, and it disturbs me greatly that I can't look at the plans that are submitted and know what is accurate. I would like that rectified, and I don't think that's all that unreasonable. It should have been done before this.
I think the engineer answered your question, that this is the schematic. That the actual detailed plan is in your possession showing the distances.
I would like to point out that subdivision plat, as you've pointed out, is a very official document, and if that's incorrect and I'm supposed to make judgments based on a plan that is called also the general site plan, that it's not a hardship to have those correct.
No, but the detail that you're asking is on a plan that was submitted to you.
Yes, but I'm also pointing out that it is in direct contradiction to the materials you've also. Yes, it is, Mr. Frensko. I know how to read these plans.
Well, I mean, the actual dimensions are shown on the detailed plan. They are not shown on the recording plat.
That's not what I was asking for, the actual dimensions. I was asking for the footprint. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman? Sorry, you done?
Mm-hmm.
I did have a follow-up question that you didn't recognize me. I'm not trying to butt in again, but that's all right. For some of the, I've only been on the board a little over a year, and this project and the previous projects predates that by, I guess, another 30 years. There is a note on the recording plat that I'd just like to have the planner discuss with the board as to what the implications of this note is, and that's under the signature block. It says, the Highlands at Broad Cove subdivision constitutes a revision to the previously recorded subdivision dated 8360 and entitled I. Allen Balfour Hunts Point, recorded in book such and such at the book number 77, plate 2 at the Cumberland County Registry of Deeds. What is the implication of that note?
That there was a subdivision plan that was recorded for the property that you now see before you, and that this plan would supersede that plan that's been recorded.
May I help, Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
I think maybe I was the only one around, except yourself. the plan originally contemplated, when this issue arose, showed, I don't know if I have that old plan with me, but a proposed road up into Phase 2 was shown as a lot. You got that plan, Mike?
No, I don't.
I've got it right here. I just
don't want to take my
face off Mr. Emery. Well, no, that's on the plan. If I just go to Phase 2, let's see. It's like Cove View Road, the beginning of Cove View Road,
mm-hmm,
on Phase 2. On the plan that's referenced, was not shown as a roadway. This shows it as a roadway, and when we had the initial discussions, the then town planner asked us, through the town attorney and the planning board, to clear up any questions between the Hunts Point Road Extension to Subdivision, the name of which I own Balfour Hunts Point, and to show that on this plan, and that would be required to constitute an amendment to the old plan, and the question arose as to how best deal with that amendment, and the resolution that was reached between the applicant, myself, the town attorney, and the board was the best way to deal with the actual amendment was to show it on the final plan of the Highlands, which would then reference that change in the registry when it was recorded.
There's nothing from that previous plan that accrues to this plan. There's no density bonus chain, no setback.
No,
there's nothing
developed
in that reference,
no,
that implies that someone might be able to develop more densely on a lot than this plan has been able to discover.
No, sir, that's correct.
That issue was addressed
way back
when Marion Guthrie was the chairperson at that time, and it was discussed at the same time we discussed the issue of whether this was actually two subdivisions or one, and the superseding of this plan over the Al Balfour plan.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
The recording final subdivision plat drawing C-100 doesn't have all those nice restrictions and conditions that are on C-101. It has some. But
let me just peek at C-101. So I can understand what you may mean. General site plan?
Yes.
Yes. That gets back to the issue of just using short form deeds. If you're not going to record this with all the conditions on it, then they don't get referred. And it's important to me that they all be recorded somewhere.
They are.
Well,
but I guess what you're saying is some of these are construction details. Some of them reference sources of information. If you look in the upper right hand corner.
Yeah. Yeah. Excuse me.
These are construction drawings to limit the contractor's activity. I think they are the same as the conditions on the recording.
There aren't anywhere near as many. Maybe I'm just going on quantity then.
Oh, okay. Some of them are not appropriate.
Some of them, though, I agree. Some of them, you know, where the trucks come in and go out of, obviously aren't relevant. But I just want to make sure that and I probably should have reviewed that to make absolutely certain of that. But that would be my...
Mr. Emery?
I want to be very clear on the matter in front of us, and I'm sure if I went through the proposed motions in detail, I would be clear, but let me ask it publicly. Are we, how much of this plan are we swallowing? Are we dealing with phase one, or are we dealing with all phases with the understanding that, well, I'll leave it at that.
Perhaps Maureen can clarify that.
The motion that you could be considering is only approval of phase one. However, I guess my understanding would be that the board would be comfortable with the entire subdivision as proposed and only be approving phase one. And I can't see any reason for somehow indicating that in your motion for approval, if you wanted to do that.
We only have adequate information for approving, well, no. Letter of credit only deals with phase one. Since we don't have a letter of credit for the subsequent phases, can we in fact approve, or would we be able to approve those phases if we were to approve the overall plan tonight?
No, you could not approve the other phases. However, you could, and I'll wait for the town attorney to correct me, you could indicate I guess your general consensus on the other phases. In addition, you could condition your approval of phase one upon a schedule of getting the subsequent phases in a timely manner.
Mr. Chairman, the subdivision ordinance regarding phasing would allow the board to sign the plat plan for phase one. You could approve the phasing of 2A, B, and C, and that would, upon showing or presenting a letter of credit appropriate to or approved by town manager and staff and town attorney, they could get the next phase plat signed, and that would be recorded. So the only thing that would get recorded, assuming phase one were approved, would be the plan showing just phase one. And then
you have 3 years to get the whole thing done.
Right, there's 3 years to finalize the remaining phases according to the ordinance. So assuming you are all happy with the plan, approve it. The remaining phases would only get recorded upon presentation of an appropriate letter of credit for that remaining phase. Does that answer your question?
Almost.
It's not just the presenting of the letter of credit for phase two, but it would also be going through this process again for phase two?
No, you have to go through any questions that you have, any problems that you see, we should get resolved now, so that upon presentation of a suitable letter of credit, they could get phase 2A signed, and then that would be recorded. The ordinance you can impose such conditions as you deem necessary to assure the orderly development of the subdivision. If phasing is permitted, the board shall grant final approval only to those phases and improvements. The board shall sign and the applicant shall record only those phases that have been given final approval. And in order to get final approval, they would have to have the appropriate letter of credit. So So the idea behind phasing is so that you don't have to have a letter of credit for the entire project. You can get a smaller letter of credit for phase one. When that gets completed, you can get a letter of credit for phase two, present that, and have the plan signed for phase two, and that would get recorded.
If conditions are not met that are a part of a final approval, are not met by the time the request to sign phase two, what are the planning board's rights and responsibilities?
There shouldn't be any conditions except for presentation of the letter of credit. I mean, for the additional phasings. I mean, any issues should be resolved at this point.
His question was, if you hadn't met the condition of the final attached, you wouldn't get phase two.
The question was, if conditions weren't met,
mm-hmm.
That were conditions of approval phase one, the applicant or the developer couldn't move on to phase two. Is that correct?
He couldn't move on, yeah. If you had...
Couldn't sell a lot in phase one.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Can't transfer. Okay.
I had something to share.
So...
The council and I had a discussion on this, and it was imposed upon me to build out up to pavement phase one, which is a very expensive and a non-return item, the water line, the road, et cetera, to provide access to the rest of Broad Cove, including now power, water, and emergency access. And I was willing to do that. That's why I phased the project, so I could complete phase one up to binder course of pavement, which was agreed to, and then roll into subsequent phases. But I cannot go into subsequent phases until I bring phase one up to snuff according to the letter of credit.
Jenna.
Mr. Chairman, Peter, let me just understand how it is that we should address this issue. First of all, if we need to look at the project. Well, I guess, first of all, let me ask you this. What are your intentions with respect to when the land, which is to be public land, would be dedicated? You've got some land along phase one, and you've got some land along phase two. Are you going to be doing all of that right now? Are you going to be doing it some of it now, or some of it when you do phase two? You understand the question?
Dedication occurs immediately upon approval and recording.
Of the whole thing, although we're only approving phase one at this point.
That's
if
right.
We do approve it.
Yes, ma'am. Well, you're only allowing construction to go forth on phase one.
But the dedication...
Dedication takes place immediately. However, to protect the public and Mr. Kennedy, we would not actually transfer title until any construction that has to take place adjacent to the land to be transferred is completed. So there won't be heavy equipment in there and the public using that portion of the property at the same time.
Well, then my question...
Dedication takes place immediately.
Well, then perhaps I'm not clear on what the legal ramifications are of dedication. Let's
offer to transfer, accepted by the town.
Let's suppose, just for the sake of argument, none of us has a crystal ball, but let's suppose for the sake of argument that phase one is approved, and that Mr. Kennedy builds out phase one, and that for whatever reason, the remaining phases are not completed. My question has to, and the three-year period expires, and Mr. Kennedy goes his separate way, whatever. At that point, what is the town left with respect to the public lands and the easements and whatnot?
Well, it's...
I'm not sure what construction takes.
I read the papers tomorrow, and I'm being foreclosed on. The only reason I buy the papers. it's an interesting question. I guess the new owner of the land is subject to the terms and conditions of the approved plat. And upon his completion of phases 2A, B, C, construction-wise, as Paul said, The dedication has already been done, but now the transfer of title occurs when he has finished construction.
But there would be no, the new, it would not be incumbent on the new owner to do the specific.
I believe there is.
Oh, sure.
Well, but the, also the new owner could do nothing. I mean.
Well, he couldn't build a house either.
That's true.
So he said,
would we be
until
raw
we went
land.
Through the.
Be raw land, undeveloped product. Mm-hmm. Our only concern is a liability concern for allowing the public in on public access recreational property at the same time heavy construction equipment is working, including utility equipment, is working in the identical area.
Think about it.
Okay,
thank you.
There are two issues right now, and I'd like to move on to, you know, just read briefly from Section 16.2.4 in the Subdivision Ordinance, Number 9. Preliminary plan approval shall not constitute approval of the final plan, but rather shall be deemed an expression of approval of the approach submitted on the preliminary plan as a guide to preparation of the final plan. I think the composite board and the questions that have come up, I sense some questions that need to be answered by our town council. I think the extent to which the preliminary plan has committed us in any way to deliberating on a final plan. There are questions in my mind, there are questions I sense in other planning board members. I'd like to call for a short executive session if we could.
I think the appropriate procedure would be to make a motion for executive session to discuss the legal rights and responsibilities of the board.
So moved. Well, you moved?
No.
So moved.
There a second? There a second. Moved and seconded. Any discussion? All those in favor in going to executive session, raise your hand. Opposed? It's unanimous vote. We'll plan to be back in a as short a period of time as possible. Reminding the public, we don't make decisions. We're simply discussing with the legal counsel. Back to order. It's 10:29. It did last a little longer than I thought. I'm sorry, we were out for about 25 minutes. I'd like to reopen any discussion. Questions to be asked by the board? Yes, Julie.
I would like to enter onto the record of an incident where Mr. Kennedy and I spoke briefly and in modest terms about this project last Saturday. There was nothing discussed that's not on the record or that hasn't been presented, but I do want it known.
Thank you. Any other discussion? Questions? The applicant is at the podium to answer any, if we have some.
Or I can have somebody who can
yes.
answer them.
Mr. Chairman, I guess I'd like to explore a bit further the issue of having the town accept the land in fee that was initially intended for the land trust. And I just don't remember, that perhaps wasn't involved enough earlier on. Maybe either Mr. Frinsco or Maureen could shed some more light on the advantages and disadvantages of accepting in fee as opposed to accepting an easement.
I don't know what the public policy is, but that was a request that was made of the applicant through the town, that it be in fee and not just an easement. We offered an easement originally, a conservation easement originally. I suspect the town would like to have control of the use of that property for recreational purposes. That's all I can guess, and I am only guessing.
Perhaps Maureen?
I guess I can suggest some other policy reasons. One would be that sometimes conservation easements are a little bit more difficult to enforce than an actual in-fee transfer of land. There can sometimes be a perception on behalf of the landowner that the property line extends throughout the area where the easement is, and where you might not have any kind of alteration of the land if it's clearly owned by the town, if it's owned by an individual lot owner, but there's an easement over it. Sometimes there can be enforcement problems with that. Additionally, I believe the town expected this land to be taken for use of all the members of the town, whereas if it were a conservation easement, it might be restricted to just the other residents of the subdivision. Third, I do believe it's a policy of the town to take land in fee. There was a memo sent to the planning board last fall from the town council chair where they particularly expressed their support of that provision in the subdivision ordinance that expects that dedication of land, and further stated that they would like to see more land dedicated to the town than to other bodies.
Thank you. Both.
Questions? Comments? I can see some of our board members making notes. If there are no further questions right now, what I'd like to do without taking any recess or leaving the podium here, just to take a 2 or 3 minutes. If you have notes that you want to collect, I take it we may be approaching a time of making a motion. This is a fairly complex application. Without leaving the podium, I think all the board members should make notes so we don't forget, you don't forget the items of concern, and you want to make sure are part of any motion made. We'll just discontinue discussion for about probably 3 or 4 minutes while people are making notes.
Has there been any resolution to the reapplication or appeal to DEP regarding the paved roadway?
My understanding is there's been no further resolution of that. One of the attachments is a copy of the appeal letter signed by the applicant, and I don't know that there's been any further action on that. Perhaps you can enlighten us, sir.
Mr. Chairman, I spoke to the staff person who reviewed the original application. She's reviewing the application to pave the emergency access road. She is working on it, but she often says that she has a tremendous amount of work to do, and she'll get it. And I'll do that.
Thank you. Thank you. I give the board two more minutes, would that be appropriate?
Mm-hmm. Like a final.
I'm ready.
I'm looking with my head down, I guess. I'm sorry. Okay, if the board is ready, are there any further questions at all of the applicant or of the other board members?
I'm not sure whether this is the place to bring it up or not. There are some things that are in our motion that, to my mind, have been resolved. And I just want to, such as the temporary CMP easement. Or they could be resolved, not necessarily, as long as we show them.
Maureen?
Or the motions you have before you are merely drafts, which are there for you to revise as you see fit.
If there are no other questions, do I hear a motion from the board?
Mr. Chairman?
Ms. Demery?
A motion for approval with conditions. Shall I have a finding of facts?
Yes, please. Read it in its entirety, if you please.
One, the applicant, Peter D. Kennedy of Greater Portland Development Group Incorporated, proposes to develop a 20-lot subdivision known as the Highlands at Broad Cove. Two, the subdivision plan received preliminary subdivision approval in May 1990 and requires final subdivision approval. Three, there is currently a CMP easement and electric cable on the site which is not depicted on the plans and which could endanger the public health, safety, and welfare if not appropriately incorporated into the subdivision plans. I would amend that to also state that we would want to see the proposed easements indicated on the plans.
They are, okay.
Performance guarantee for the improvements to the site is required by the subdivision ordinance and has not been submitted in final form. Five, some sanitary disposal systems have been located in the buffer areas, and in the case of Lot 1, Phase 1, the building envelope does not include the location of existing systems. Six, the applicant has requested approval of Phase 1 of the subdivision only. The remaining three phases have also been reviewed by the planning board and should be constructed in a timely fashion after the first phase, or as required by the subdivision ordinance. The subdivision includes a farmhouse which contributes to the historic resources of the town and the aesthetic character of the subdivision. Eight, the subdivision ordinance requires that open space be dedicated in all new developments. Two significant parcels located in the subdivision are not buildable due to the presence of wetlands and DEP site location order. Nine, Phase 2 pedestrian easement has been proposed to provide a relatively dry pedestrian trail. It's part of the town's greenbelt plan. Because some of the lot configurations in Lot 2 are not compatible with natural features and topography of the site, the easement does not border on the proposed parcel to be dedicated. 10, the configuration of lots 4 and 6 in Phase 1 includes portions of unbuildable lot which are on the southerly side of the road and conflict with the physical character of topography of the area. 11, the subdivision generally complies with requirements of final subdivision approval. 12, I want to be clear that the wording is correct on this. Peter D. Kennedy of Greater Portland Development Group has received a DEP site location approval for the proposed subdivision. Therefore, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the request of Peter Kennedy of the Greater Portland Development Group Incorporated for final subdivision approval of Phase 1 of the Highlands, a 20-lot subdivision located in the area of Channelville Road,
Channel View Road, Hunts Point Road Extension, Winding Way, and Two Lights Road be granted according to Section 16-2-4C of the subdivision ordinance, subject to the following conditions. Condition one was that the temporary CMP easement be shown. That has been discussed and been resolved, so that is no longer applicable.
But, excuse
we
me,
seen it
right.
Okay.
I think I'd like to, whatever, if you want to include that as
okay.
a condition, read it in its entirety,
okay.
or whatever entirety.
All right, I'll do that. I'll just read it as is. That the temporary CMP easement and electrical cable be added to the plans and demonstrated to the town engineer and town planner that it will not adversely impact the design in construction of the subdivision and its individual lots. Two, that an irrevocable letter of credit in the amount of $281,000 be submitted to the town manager and town attorney for their review and approval, and then filed with the town treasurer within 30 days of the date of this approval and prior to the start of any construction on site. Three, that all new sanitary disposal systems be located outside the buffer strip areas. Four, that a note be added to the plan which precludes the demolition of the farmhouse for other than reasons of public safety. Five, the deeds and revised plans for land dedications of the northerly and southerly parcels of the site to the town be submitted to the town attorney and town planner for review and approval prior to the start of any construction on site. Six, that the lots bordering the northern parcel be reduced as much as allowed by the zoning ordinance to allow the current placement of a pedestrian easement to border the land to be dedicated to the town. And seven, that the portions of lots 4 and 6 in Phase 1 that lie south of the road be added to the land parcel to be donated to the town. 8, that the final subdivision approval of the remaining phases in the subdivision be granted, subject to approval by the plats, of the plats by the planning board within 3 years of this approval. 9, that all plans be brought and made consistent with each other, particularly Plan C-101 and consistent with Plan C-100.
Did you get that? Okay.
10, that the applicant submits his DEP approval to the town and all pertinent state permits. 11, that the applicant provides additional buffering along the Brown property line. And 12, that the overall subdivision plan is referenced on Plan C-100.
Could you repeat number 11 for me, please? I believe it had to do with the Brown
property. That the applicant provide additional buffering along the Brown property line, contiguous to the... Jordan Farm Road right-of-way line.
Mr. Emery, would you repeat number 12?
That the overall subdivision plan is referenced on Plan C-100. Do I have that correct? Excuse me, that Plan C-100 is referenced on the Phase 1 plat drawing. Is that C-100A? Yes, it is. C-100A is...
Yeah, that's an utilities and layout.
Shall I continue?
Yes, please.
Findings of fact for public waiver, access waiver. One, Peter Kennedy of Greater Portland Development Group is seeking final subdivision approval for a 20-lot subdivision known as the Highlands. Two.
Hold on, this is another order. I thought
this was
another order.
Oh, is it?
Mm-hmm. It's another order. So, shall we have a second to this one and discuss this one?
Excuse me.
Mm-hmm.
Sorry about that.
It's possible that you may, since it's two different orders, it's possible you may approve one and not approve the other, so you may want to discuss them separately.
For the general public, we're debating whether to include the public access waiver in with the overall motion or not. Mr. Emery, would you like to include that? Or?
No, I'll
okay. So your motion stops with number 12?
That's correct.
Do I hear a second?
I second the motion.
It's been moved and seconded. The motion as read. Are the questions on the individual conditions or any other? There's a long involved.
I have some questions.
Okay. It's open to further discussion or questions.
Yeah, all right. Can I talk now?
Sure, Judith.
Some of the comments that I would bring up that I would... the condition one, that final permanent easement be executed and recorded and noted as being in the roadway in phase one, which I believe is where it's going. Is that right? I had a small semantics probably in condition three, that all new sanitary disposal systems be located inside the building envelope, which seems to be the word we were using most. I questioned condition 6 and 7, which is the substantial changing of the lot lines. I added all conditions except those specifically addressing constructions be delineated on the recording plat or in a separate recordable document.
Excuse me, Judith, perhaps I missed at the very beginning. Are you asking for amendments?
Well, I guess I'm...
Would you like to discuss them?
Okay. I would like to discuss.
Okay.
I'd like to amend and discuss, I guess. Amend the first one to include the permanent easement be executed and recorded. I would like to discuss 6 and 7, which is the changing of the lot lines. I just wonder at this point, we've brought this up to the applicant. It's been this way since the DEP brought it back. I'm not sure how I feel about this,
okay.
About changing it at the last minute. I think it wouldn't bring any of the lots into a non-conforming size, would it? No.
The discussion that centered around that had to do with the fact that there was additional acreage.
Going into land.
It contained no building area,
mm-hmm.
In essence, other than additional square footage, added nothing to those sites. And that it would be added in fee simple to the...
To the land term, or to the town.
I just have a comment on number three, to changing it, and perhaps the motion E would make comment as well, that the original motion was located outside the buffer strip areas. That makes it more specific to the fact that there are buffer areas to the property lines. I'd like to open for discussion whether we might add to that outside the buffer strip areas that shall be a minimum of 15 feet from property lines and 15 feet from wetlands boundaries.
I don't think that it's necessary to state a 15-foot minimum with respect to the wetlands, because I think the soils and state review would provide something more severe than that. The 15-foot side yard, I think, would be appropriate. It's 5 feet more than what's required at state level, but I still think is appropriate given the goal of providing adequate buffer between the properties.
As it pertains to the septic system. Location.
That's correct.
That's right. I'm not sure that there are state minimums for wetlands. I was not aware that there are. I couldn't find any.
There are none?
No. And that's why we have Lot 10 with it sitting close, if not in.
Well, then I'll accept 15 feet.
Mr. Chairman, for purposes of discussion, the applicant does have a note 17 on their general site plan, C101, that lists a formula I understand they used at least for portions of their wetland setback, and I wonder if that might be appropriate if you're trying to define it. I can read it for anyone who doesn't have it in front of them. Minimum setback from wetlands established using Natural Resources Protection Act criteria for permit by rule, 25 feet plus 2 times average slope of land. Times the average slope of the land, multiplied by the average slope of the land.
But the formula doesn't say whether you add the 25 and the 2 and then multiply, or whether you take 25 and then add
no
the 2 times.
The
old mathematical question.
Scott?
I can clarify that.
I thought perhaps you could.
25 feet plus.
So it's a minimum of 27 feet? Oh, no, it's a minimum of 25. It's at least 25 feet plus something.
That's a permit by rule standard. In some situations, you can apply for a permit just for one sheet of paper, and if you meet those standards, you can get the permit initially. Not this type of project, but I use those guidelines on this project.
That would also be acceptable to me.
So, just so I understand what the suggestion is, with respect to...
Janet, excuse me, I think we have to be real careful about whether we're opening for discussion or proposing to amend to the motion.
I thought it was a proposal to amend.
On number 3, I had opened it for discussion. I wanted to hear the discussion. Tom made a comment about it, but I'm not sure what was formally... I mean, when we get through all of these, I'm going to ask Maureen to go back now through those conditions and read them back to make sure they're as we intend them to be.
But we have a motion on the floor
right now,
and we can't change that motion unless we have an amendment.
That's right.
It was proposed.
The only changes will be, ask Mr. Emery if he would accept an amendment, and then he either will or won't. I would like to ask Mr. Emery to amend number 3 to read as follows, that all new sanitary disposal systems be located outside the buffer strip areas that shall be a minimum of 15 feet from property lines and 15 feet from wetland boundaries. Is that acceptable to you? You can say yes or
no. Shall I tell you what would be acceptable to me?
You can if you'd like to.
That all new sanitary disposal systems be located outside the buffer strips, which shall be 15 feet minimum from property lines and 25 feet plus 2 times the average slope away from wetland boundaries.
I'll accept that as the seconder of the motion.
Thank you. I think that also incorporates Judy's comment, and now as an amendment. Any other amendments or requests for amendments? Discussion on the conditions? Discussions on the findings of fact motion?
Mr. Chairman, I have a couple small points on the findings of fact in item number 4. Mr. Emery noted that a performance guarantee had not been submitted in final form. I'd like to insert the word timely before submitted. I believe the proper statement would be that it's not been timely submitted in final form. With respect to item number 6 on the findings of fact, I'd like to ask Mr. Emery to I wasn't clear about what his second sentence was. The remaining three phases have also been reviewed by the planning board. I think I'd like to just have the sentence end there, because that's the accurate statement of fact.
Your comments on those, Ms. Demmer? Or other board members, for that matter?
Mm-hmm.
Questions?
I agree with her comments.
I guess my only question... Okay, we're dealing with findings of fact.
That's the fact.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Your second part of the statement
yes,
had to do with as by subdivision ordinance.
But is it not also a fact that the ordinance requires a timely implementation of future phases?
Withdraw my suggestion.
Thank you. Okay, the suggestion that was withdrawn applied to number 6, but you're still requesting that you add the word timely before the word submitted in number 4?
That's correct, and my only other request, at least right now, is that in the conditions number 8, that the comma before within be taken out so that it reads that final subdivision approval of the remaining phases in the subdivision be granted, comma, subject to approval of the plats by the planning board within 3 years of this approval.
We're done. You're hearing here? That was as a condition. Is the addition, Ms. Emery, of the word timely to number 4 and findings of fact acceptable?
That's fine.
It comes from the second E. Second it as well.
Yes.
Any others? Would the board like to have Maureen or plan on read down through the entirety or just through the conditions themselves? Okay. If you could, Maureen, just read down through the conditions as read and as amended.
Okay. As I understand it, condition 1 and condition 2 are not amended. Condition 3 would read that all new sanitary disposal systems be located outside the buffer strips that shall be a minimum of 15 feet from property lines and 25 feet plus 2 times the slope from wetland boundaries. Number 4 is unchanged. Number 5 is unchanged. Number 6 and 7 are unchanged. Number 8 reads that final subdivision approval of the remaining phases in the subdivision be granted, comma, subject to the approval of the plats by the planning board within 3 years of this approval. No second comma. 9 would read that all plans be made consistent with plan C101 and C100.
That's correct.
I thought was all plans were consistent with 100 and 101 being an example.
That's right. It was consistent with each other. That's right. For example, you're right.
With consistent with each other.
That all plans be made consistent with each other.
As an example, is that right?
Okay.
As an example, see
yes.
101
mm-hmm.
and 100.
As an example, C101 and C100. Okay. 10, that the applicant submit its DEP and all other state approvals to the town.
Correct.
Does that include federal approvals or just state?
State and federal.
Okay. Number 11, that the applicant provide additional buffering along the ground property line contiguous to Jordan Crown Road.
Correct.
And 12, that plan C100 is referenced on plats C-100A. And then there was an amendment to Condition 1. Did you want that added in? I believe that, actually Condition 1 did have an amendment that the last line would be that a final permanent easement be executed and recorded in Phase 1.
That was my amendment, right.
Was that acceptable?
Yes, it is.
Yes.
And I don't have any other notes of amendments.
There was one other amendment. Perhaps I was incorrect in stating it, in that the all the conditions that were stated on plan C-101 be referenced onto or in a separate document recorded, at least the ones that were non-construction or non-construction specific. Can you say, do you know what I'm trying to say?
That all non-construction specific conditions on plan C-101 be referenced on the recording plat?
The recording plat, or in a separate recordable document.
Okay, and that would be condition 13, that all non-construction specific conditions on plan C-01 be referenced on the recording plat or separate recordable document.
Is that acceptable?
Yes, it is.
Yes.
Janet? Any other questions? Discussion? We have a motion before us. Discussion on the motion? Judy?
Is it appropriate to indicate at this point why I will vote the way I will on this motion, or is that not appropriate?
I think you can vote, voice it in any concern you might have as a form of discussion without necessarily stating that you're going to vote one way or another. Just say that you have a real concern about one or another.
Then I will state that I have a concern with a motion of this nature granting approval with this many conditions. I, as a planning board member, would expect a lot of these plan discrepancy issues, general cleaning up issues, be done before one makes a final decision on such a motion.
I think as the chairperson, it's always a concern when we have this many conditions. I'm not going to say it encumbers the status of the application, but it certainly makes it difficult to come to some type of judgment as a planning board member. It is a result, I think, of a number of different items that were not completed within the last 30 days. Any other discussion, any other sense or feeling about that? Or any question about what happens in the condition process?
I have a personally, again, with these many conditions, is that, you know, you have 13 conditions, and if you, as a planning board member, have a disagreement with one of them that's substantial enough that you agree with the other 12, you're caught in the position of, well, should I vote for it and forget how I feel about that one? It's just not, there are so many and they're so different. I personally wonder if the condition stage of approval, we should be changing lot lines. That
I think that's something you have to come to a decision in your own mind. Is that an issue which causes you to vote one way or another? Is it significant enough? I know in certain cases, not in this case, myself. If it is, then the vote, should this motion not pass, then the next step is just to go on to say, well, what conditions or what, we've been through the process, you know, it takes an affirmative vote for approval or tabling or for denial. It's not always a one-step process. If enough board members feel that this is too encumbering, then we simply take a vote, and if it doesn't pass, then we try again.
Mr. Chairman, I don't know if there's any more discussion from the board. If there isn't, and I'd like to hear from the applicant if the applicant has any comments on any of the conditions. I don't know whether the conditions are new to the applicant.
I think if we could make it a timely
I don't know whether the applicant has anything to say.
Brief. That's a good term.
My concerns go deeper than Judith Kane's. The number of conditions which you have proposed have already been accomplished. Quite a few of them have already been accomplished and are in before you. Several of the conditions which you've added, such as buffering, have been offered by the applicant. No problem at all. There are conditions, however, that I would urge you to review with your legal counsel. And I'll run down them. And number one, if I might ask a question, I'm not sure what you mean by showing the permanent easement, utility easement on the final plan. It has been on here since day one, so I'm not, am I missing something there? We made it very clear the new utility line will be in the road, and it's shown on the detailed drawings. So I'm not.
But it's not indicated on the plat.
I think
the town will own that road in fee, because by law we are required to transfer land within a roadway in fee to the town. We will not own that land when it becomes part of the town. There won't be an easement. You'll have the whole road in fee. I don't want to complicate things, but that's the way we have to do things now.
I think the complicating part for us was this was not an issue that was even made apparent to us until the last 30 days. And it makes it very difficult at the time of the site walk. It was the first time I've been with us for almost 2 years.
No, I understand, but the condition was amended to include a requirement that the final permanent easement be shown on the plan and recorded. And all I can say to you is it is shown on the plan because the utility will be in the road, it will be recorded, and the town will own that parcel of land and fee.
Okay. So if it's already on the plan, then it's a condition that's easily met. Is that correct?
I was trying to clarify what it was you wanted recorded because I didn't understand the amendment.
I guess my experience is maybe a little different because I've dealt with private roads versus public roads, but we've always been asked by planning boards to indicate public utilities and all of those various easements that fall within the road right-of-way on the recording plat.
I guess also we're following, to a certain extent, our town engineer's advice, where he makes it makes a statement: the recording plat should show the CMP easement. If it's already on there, then it's a condition that's met. If it's not, then we require it.
Obviously, it's not a problem. Obviously, the problem we have is that you're suggesting that there is some requirement in the ordinance for a buffer strip area of a certain size when you get to the condition number 3.
Are we skipping over to something else there?
No, I'm just going on to the next comment.
Oh, okay.
I don't believe there is. We have placed the buffer strips as proposed. They have not changed. We do not propose to change them. We understand your concerns. We have considered them as the ordinance requires, but I don't believe that this condition is supported by the ordinance.
I think we understand that.
I understand that. The fourth one, if you are saying that you want a preservation covenant attached to the farmhouse on lot 1, I must respectfully suggest to you that what you are doing is saying that no one may ever remove that farmhouse. That is a taking, which I don't believe is supported by the ordinance. The same holds true with respect to demanding an additional conveyance of land be included in 5 has already been accomplished, 6 and 7. I can't find any place in the ordinance that gives the planning board the authority to acquire this land by making it a condition of approval. 8 is a matter of the ordinance anyway, and I have no problem with it. But those are the real problems. The real problems are you have standards written out, which I call rules, and you have a state subdivision statute. I firmly believe that the plan before you meets all of those standards. We can disagree, but I think you have an obligation to found any condition by state law and by ordinance in a particular section of the subdivision ordinance. That's the purpose of condition. And I don't believe that there is any foundation in the ordinance for some of these conditions, those which I've addressed.
May I point to one issue? We also are required to look at our comprehensive plan. And I will use the farmhouse as an example. There are certain, I'm certainly not an attorney, but I know there are many ways in which one can devise a plan to meet the policies and goals and so forth of the comprehensive plan and the standards set forth in the ordinance. And it certainly seems to me as a fair trade-off to for the very fact that we have placed that access road directly adjacent to an existing house, regardless of their proximity to the property line. Those are existing conditions that I think should be taken into consideration, and I don't think it's up to this planning board to tell you whether or not a 9-foot buffer is required. I've kept this in as a condition because I think the only excuse for locating the road the way it is because the existing farmhouse is located in that location, and that the fact that there's an impact on that at that intersection is directly related to the fact that that farmhouse preserves the rural character of Cape Elizabeth, which is indeed part of our comprehensive plan. And I'm not going to dig through the standards now and pull them all out, but I'd be very happy to if you want to wait another month, and I'll get all those standards and I'll put them beside these conditions. Other than that, I would offer to withdraw my motion and table the project at this point.
Or I think our planner would certainly volunteer to put those standards beside. Mr. Frenzko's comments are his own opinion.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we can respectfully disagree, Mr. Emery.
Sure, I understand.
I hope everybody understands that for at least since the 60s, there has been a road planned in that location. The plan, an approved and recorded plan.
That's the very reason I brought up the question before.
It was requested that
before.
We don't build a road there to preserve a squash barn, if you will. We do that, but my point was what you are placing is, on this plan, you are placing a permanent restriction on the use of this land. And I honestly, with all due respect, don't believe that you have that authority. I think Mr. Kennedy addressed it from a pragmatic point of view. He's not going to put the amount of money he's put in there to tear it down tomorrow. But someone in the future may, and that will seriously affect the value of the property.
In both directions. It could very well protect the value of the property.
Next. And I think that is, at least from the motion and the second, the opinion of those people on the board.
I understand that. I'm not trying to change it. I'm simply telling you that the problem that we have with it, you asked for our comments, and I think very candidly we gave them.
Mm-hmm. I respect that.
May I just speak to that issue? I was at first, I was disturbed by these ongoing ad infinitum sort of restrictions and conditions. Who's going to enforce them? Who's benefited by them? What if someone knocks it down in the year 2025? Is the town going to come in? Who's going to get the benefit of it, who's going to, this goes on, is it going to be a fee simple determinable, is it going to be all sorts of nasty nasties that we can cook up?
I don't remember what those are anymore.
Oh, those are automatic reverters. Those are the ones that are really bad. But then I came back to some of the original very preliminary hearings when, I'm reaching back into my own memory and my own feelings about it, which were that the road that was proposed was basically almost nonconforming in the sense that it was, well, I won't say nonconforming, that's not the word I want, but it was really close, and there was a question about tearing down part of the squash barn and mm-hmm. reserving part of it, and it would be a lot better off if we could keep the farmhouse and the whole thing and have the road closer to the buildings. And it seemed nice, and Peter's done a wonderful job. I can't imagine his either, or anybody buying that property, considering doing anything other than with it than what you would want to. And I guess for my mind, it was a toss-up. I just figured for what it's worth, the chances of anybody wanting to tear it down and putting up a 7-Eleven. Well,
the problem is the restriction in perpetuity creates an encumbrance on the land forever forward. That creates a value problem with the property, and I hope you understand that. I don't think anybody's going to tear it down, but at some point in time, it
well,
will have
I've
a...
Well, I've talked from both sides, and I'm probably the person that least likes...
I think it's a case of, right now it's an economic issue of contribution to the total value of the site. Mm-hmm. When does it become, by the effective age of the property, non-contributory to the overall value? The condition simply says that the board wishes it to be a condition that the farm site, the farmhouse, is always a part of that site. Whether that's a good motion or not, that's the question.
In layman's terms, what is the house burned down?
Only said if demolition is not burned down. Other than reasons for public safety, I suppose a burned down building would be a threat to public safety.
And what do you build in its place?
Think at that time anything you want that conforms to the site.
I understand your concerns. I hope we've addressed the buffering concerns.
As one board member, and I don't want to continue at length on this. I appreciate your comments. My own reflection on that is that you've done whatever you wanted to do with the buffer areas to suit your septic systems. That's not the intent of this board member. The intent.
That's a fair comment.
Okay.
All I'm saying is I don't believe there's any foundation in the ordinance for a greater restriction.
I understand that. And it is your opinion that we only enact on those ordinance issues.
It isn't my opinion. It's what the town council said and the legislature said, believe it or not.
Mm. Other comments? Discussion? None appearing. I'll call this to a vote. Is it clear to the people, the board members, what the amendments are, what the conditions are? Okay. Call to a vote. All those in favor of this motion as read and as amended, please raise your right hand. Those opposed, raise your right hand. The vote was 2 in favor and 3 opposed. Situate, we're back to square one here. In respect for the time, do I hear another motion on the floor? Did you get these to the folks? In favor.
on McKay and Kane Post.
What are the board's wishes at this time?
Mr. Chairman, I'm conscious of the hour more than anything else. I guess what I'd really like to do is move that the motion be tabled until the next meeting of the planning board. I hate to extend this, and I'd be happy to have somebody else make a motion if somebody else wants to make one, frankly.
Was that the statement in the form of an actual motion? Okay.
It was
a comment.
It was a discussion.
Discussion point, okay. Judith?
I would be willing to make one more motion and see how that would go. I have to say the whole thing for her. The other thing is I have a driving urge to do this, either one way or the other. I hate to see it go on. This has lived with us for 2 years, but anyway, let me try it.
I guess in the...
Is it closer to in making a motion, the fact that it's changed to just state the fee?
You could state that in making your motion, you're amending the previous motion. If that's what you want to do.
If the changes are extensive, then I think you should...
No, they're not
right.
Substantially extensive.
Okay. What you can do is amend only those sections from the previous motion that are changes.
I will amend the following conditions of the prior motion. The condition number 6 be removed. That condition number 7 be removed.
Any other amendments?
I'm struggling with one.
Okay,
and
okay.
Just
take your time.
That the farmhouse be preserved.
Is this in lieu of number
4? In lieu of 4.
Okay.
Be preserved in... I don't want this to get too tight.
Perhaps if you could just repeat what you want to say, maybe Maureen can put it in words.
That it be preserved in the state that it is. It's historic, way it looks, its use, but that it, if it is destroyed or by fire or flood or tidal wave or whatever, that it be... I'm not sure what I want to say.
As the motion stands right now, you've excluded number 6 and number 7 of our previous motion.
Just leave the farmhouse the way it is. I can't articulate it any better for now.
Are there other amendments?
No, that's all.
Okay. Before discussion, perhaps, do I hear a second? Do I hear a second? If the motion fails, what is it? For a lack of a second. Judith? Judy?
I will propose a different motion.
Okay.
Make the following proposal. Be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the final subdivision review of a 20-lot subdivision called the Highlands and located in the area of Channel View Road, Hunts Point Road Extension, Winding Way, and Two Lights Road is tabled with the mutual agreement of both the applicant and the planning board and scheduled to the next planning board meeting after the following issues are addressed. 1. The CMP easement and electrical cable shall be depicted on the plans. If the location conflicts with the subdivision design, the applicant shall recommend appropriate steps to either incorporate the electrical service into the subdivision design or remove the cable. If the cable will be discontinued, information regarding who receives electrical service and detailed information on how electrical service will be maintained shall be submitted. 2. A draft performance guarantee shall be submitted in a final form ready for signature and approved by the town attorney and town manager. A letter from the financial institution issuing the performance guarantee stating that the letter will be signed within 30 days of planning board approval of the subdivision shall also be submitted. 3. Septic system placements in the buffer area shall be reevaluated for placement outside of buffer areas. Complete HHE 200 form shall be submitted for all relocated systems. The building envelope for Lot 1, Phase 1, shall be revised to include the sanitary disposal system. I think I'll add there that, excuse me one moment, buffer areas shall be defined as 15 feet from property lines and 25 feet plus 2 times the slope from a wetland area. 4, a note shall be added to the plans that the farmhouse and Lot 1, Phase 1 shall not be removed for reasons other than public safety. That's right. 5, a technical analysis and evidence shall be submitted demonstrating that shifting of Jordan Farm Road away from the Brown residence will compromise road design standards. If a moderate buffer strip can be designed, the road alignment shall be revised on the plans and a landscape plan shall be submitted for the buffer strip. 6. Deeds for the land dedication and pedestrian easements shall be submitted which have been approved by the town attorney and town planner. 7. Lot configurations in Phase 1 and 2 shall be revised to more closely reflect the natural features, road locations, and topography of the areas. Specifically, those sections of lots 4 and 6 in Phase 1 south of the road shall be eliminated. Northern property lines in Phase 2 shall also be adjusted to allow a dry pedestrian easement which borders the land to be donated. 8. Discrepancies between the various site plans and subdivision plats shall be eliminated. These discrepancies include but may not be limited to location of building envelopes and existing building footprints. Nine, applicant shall submit copies of all federal and state approvals. The overall subdivision plan C-100 should be referenced on subdivision plat C-100A. I think I'll let it stand there.
We have a motion. Do I hear a second?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Do we have discussion on the motion before us?
The only discussion I would have is I heard some current concerns on the applicant's part, and I heard some issues related to legal standards of reference, and I would ask that the town planner and corporation counsel work together to provide the planning board with a, whatever reference to standards is necessary in anticipation of our next meeting. And by implication, also inform us if indeed we don't have the standards that we feel we do have.
That's a matter of discussion, not amendment, I take it.
That's true.
Timothy?
Yeah, I have a question on approvals have to be submitted before the
Mr. Eichenberg, finish, please.
I just want to know the timing of the meeting of that particular condition.
I guess stating federal, that has not been obtained. I'm surmising I would revise that to indicate that applicants submit copies of all federal or state approvals obtained to date, and perhaps deal with future approvals when we make a motion for a final approval.
Timothy?
Your intent to have these approvals submitted after they have been approved to the town of Cape Elizabeth, so that they're on record? Or?
My intention would be to have them on record. It certainly would not be to stall this and have him obtain approvals not obtained to date before he comes back.
So was there a change to, did you get that, Maureen?
I guess what I'm assuming is you want to deal with most of that as part of the final approval of the plan, but if there were to be a note added to the current plan that stated that all state and federal approvals would be submitted to the town at some future date, that would probably satisfy this condition.
I might ask Mr. Emery. I tried to take that from a condition.
I see the applicant sitting squeamishly. Since the applicant has already applied or appealed the DEP decision, one can assume that the DEP site location permit is in hand. I don't know personally whether it's on file with the town. It's simply a requirement of final site plan approval to have state, federal approvals in hand prior to our approving them. So I just see that as an appropriate condition in case that hasn't been met.
So, Mr. Chairman, if I may suggest, based on this most recent discussion, perhaps Ms. Lardner would agree to delete her condition 9 from the motion with respect to tabling, and might be more appropriately discussed when we make a further motion.
I would agree to that.
And Janet, you seconded anyway, huh?
Yes.
Oops, I'm on the wrong page. Discussion of the other issues to be addressed in reference to planning, to tabling. Judy?
I'd like to clarify why I worded a couple of the things I did with respect to the CMP easement and the draft performance guarantee. I don't consider those items addressed in the package of materials I studied for the meeting, so I don't want you to think that I haven't heard what you said at the podium about whether those things have been presented or not. I would simply like those items to be addressed in a formal manner for planning board review by the next meeting.
Sorry. I had a question, and I don't have the number down, but you used the term building footprints. And if you could read back that